This is an extract from the book The Age of Responsibility, CSR 2.0 and the New DNA of Business by Wayne Visser, read by the author. Chapter 8, The Principle of Scalability, Case 7, Lee Scott and Walmart. Rapacious behemoth, aggressive, bully, and evil empire are just some of the public epithets Walmart had acquired by the time Harold Lee Scott Jr. took over as president and CEO in 2000. Fortune magazine said the company had what could be charitably described as an us versus them mentality, in which us was Walmart and them was everybody else, from critics to the competition, the government, and yes, sometimes even its own employees. The company's public image as a rapacious behemoth reflected that, they said. Businessweek reported a mounting socio-political backlash to Walmart's size and aggressive business practices and urged Walmart to stop the bullying, stop squeezing employees and suppliers, and charge customers a little more. The source of all these jibes and accusations can be traced to two killer facts. One, ever since founder Sam Walton opened the company's first store in Arkansas in 1962, Walmart has been all about discount operations, low cost and low price. And two, from its humble beginnings, Walmart mushroomed into the largest company in the world, a $405 billion giant with over 2 million employees, serving customers in more than 8,400 retail units under 55 different banners in 15 countries around the world. There is nothing about Walmart that can be described as small, other than its prices. And when it comes to price, it's hard to beat Walmart, admits Businessweek, but the everyday low prices come at a high cost to its employees. The result has been dozens of lawsuits brought by employees claiming to be overworked and underpaid, including the mother of all sex discrimination class actions, which alleges the company discriminated against 1.6 million women. In fact, there are two union-funded activist organizations, Wake Up Walmart and Walmart Watch, that exist for the sole purpose of criticizing Walmart, and that's just on labor issues. When it comes to green issues, the name Walmart has always triggered a shudder, says Grist magazine. The company has been charged with exacerbating suburban sprawl, burning massive quantities of oil via its 10,000-mile supply chain, producing mountains of packaging waste, polluting waterways with runoff from its construction sites, and encouraging gratuitous consumption. The litany of alleged sins doesn't end there either, putting small companies out of business, maltreating suppliers, offering inferior employee benefits, the list goes on and on. The point is that when Scott took charge, and for at least the first 5 years of his reign, Walmart was under siege, with a siege mentality to fit. We would put up the sandbags and get out the machine guns, Scott recalls. If somebody criticized us, my first thought was, why don't they like us? Or what could we do to them? Versus how I think now, which is, could the criticism have some truth? Fortune magazine later concluded that Scott had apparently learned that the best way to respond to an attacker was not with an attack of one's own, but to embrace them. And embrace them he did, to the extent that his journey to openness, alongside that of Walmart, is today one of the most remarkable leadership stories of our time. So what happened? And why, and how. It seems some of the seminal credit must go to one of Sam Walton's sons and to the NGO Conservation International. Rob Walton, chairman of Walmart's board of directors since 1992, is a lover of the outdoors and found himself in February 2004 on a 10-day trip to Costa Rica, hosted by Peter Seligman, co-founder and CEO of Conservation International. After pointing out the destructive havoc that fleets of fishing boats were wreaking on the delicate Costa Rican marine habitat, legend has it that Seligman looked at the Walmart chairman in the eye and said, "We need to change the way industry works, and you can have an influence." Rob was moved and promised to introduce Seligman to Scott. The timing was serendipitous, as Scott had just concluded a review of Walmart's legal and public relations problems, and it wasn't a pretty picture. The discrimination lawsuit had been certified as a federal class action. New stores were blocked by activists in Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Chicago, and the company had just forked out millions to regulators for air and water pollution infringements. The findings of two recent studies only made matters worse. One that showed that Walmart's spending on health benefits for its employees was 30% less than the average of its retail peers, and another by McKinsey, which concluded that up to 8% of shoppers had stopped patronizing the store because of its increasingly tarnished reputation. The watershed meeting took place without fanfare in June 2004, with Rob Welton, Scott Seligman, Glenn Prickett, also of Conservation International, and Jib Ellison, a river rafting guide turned management consultant. Whatever was said, it convinced Scott to dip Walmart's toes into green waters. No doubt it helped that Conservation International's board included former Intel chairman Gordon Moore, BP chief executive John Brown, and former Starbucks CEO Orrin Smith, and that Conservation International were already advising Starbucks on fair trade issues and McDonald's on sustainable agriculture and fishing. Whatever the reasons, Scott commissioned Ellison's management consulting firm, Blue Sky, to measure Walmart's total environmental impact. It was a bold move, but it quickly paid off. Blue Sky found that, for example, by eliminating excessive packaging on its Kid Connection private label line of toys, Walmart could save $2.4 million a year in shipping costs, 3,800 trees, and 1 million barrels of oil. And on its fleet of 7,200 trucks, rather than letting the truck engine idle during the driver's mandatory 10-hour breaks, it could save $26 million in fuel costs a year by installing auxiliary power units to heat or cool the cabs. In short, Walmart had belatedly discovered the win-win world of eco-efficiency, which the World Business Council for Sustainable Development had been promoting since 1992. As we headed down this first path in our sustainability journey and started to see these results, we got really excited, recalls Scott. If the truth be told, these initiatives were neither radical nor especially high impact in the context of Walmart's global footprint, and Scott could easily have stopped there, having gained the public relations benefits and the easy picking cost savings. Fortunately, however, fate intervened. On the 29th of August 2005, Hurricane Katrina hit the Louisiana coast and devastated New Orleans. Katrina was one of the worst disasters in the history of the United States, reflected Scott, but it also brought out the best in our company. We responded by doing what we do best. We empowered our people and leveraged our presence and logistics to deliver the supplies that hurricane victims so desperately needed. Hurricane Katrina changed Walmart forever, and it changed us for the better. We saw our full potential with absolute clarity, to serve not just our customers, but our communities, our countries, and even the world. We saw our opportunity and our responsibility. In the aftermath of the storm, we asked ourselves, how can we be that company, the Walmart we were during Katrina, all the time? Sustainability became a big part of the answer. And so began one of the most unexpected and remarkable stories of corporate transformation. Scott soon announced three radical goals. First, to be supplied 100% by renewable energy. Second, to create zero waste. And third, to sell products that sustain people and the environment. Admittedly, they are described as aspirational with no timelines attached, but if they get anywhere close or even halfway there, they will have been a major catalyst for the post-industrial revolution. Already we see the Walmart effect of scalability in action in three areas: fish, cotton, and light bulbs. Let's look at each in turn. Walmart plans to purchase all of its wild-caught, fresh and frozen fish for the US market from Marine Stewardship Council, or MSC, certified fisheries by 2011. They are also working with Global Aquaculture Alliance and Aquaculture Certification Council to certify that all foreign shrimp suppliers adhere to best aquaculture practice standards in the US by 2011. By 2009, they were already halfway there. Speaking to the Wall Street Journal, George Chamberlain, president of the Aquaculture Alliance, put the move in perspective. The endorsement drew attention. Walmart buys more shrimp than any other US company, importing 20,000 tons annually, about 3.4% of US shrimp imports. With Walmart's nod, we went from trying to convince individual facilities to become certified to having long waiting lines. Scott also made a commitment to phase out chemically treated textile crops. By 2008, Walmart was the largest buyer of organic cotton, with more than 10 million pounds purchased annually. They are also the world's largest purchaser of conversion cotton, cotton grown without chemicals but waiting to be certified as organic. Scott is under no illusions about the ripple effects. He says, "Cotton farmers can now invest in organic farming because they have the certainty and stability of a major buyer. Through leadership and purchasing power, all of us can create new markets for sustainable products and services. We can drive innovation. We can build acceptance. All we need is the will to step out and make the difference." Another product Scott targeted was green light bulbs. A compact fluorescent light bulb has clear advantages over the widely used incandescent light. It uses 75% less electricity, lasts 10 times longer, produces 450 pounds fewer greenhouse gases from power plants, and saves consumers $30 over the life of each bulb. But it is 8 times as expensive as a traditional bulb, gives off a harsher light, and has a peculiar appearance. As a result, the compact fluorescent bulbs only ever achieved 6% penetration, before Walmart, that is. To tip the scales in favor of compact fluorescence, Walmart set the goal of selling 100 million energy-saving light bulbs. Success would mean total sales in the US would double, saving Americans $3 billion in electricity costs and avoiding the need to build additional power plants for the equivalent of 450,000 new homes. To ram home the point about Walmart's mighty sway, according to the New York Times, when they proposed this audacious goal, light bulb manufacturers who sell millions of incandescent lights at Walmart immediately expressed reservations. In a December 2005 meeting with executives from General Electric, Walmart's largest bulb supplier, the message from GE was, "Don't go too fast. We have all these plants that produce traditional bulbs." The response from the Walmart buyer was uncompromising. "We are going there. You decide if you are coming with us." Unsurprisingly, General Electric decided to tool up and scale up to meet the demand. Today, these and other initiatives are all part of Walmart's Sustainability 360-degree program. Compounding the scalability effect is the fact that Walmart plans to take its more than 100,000 suppliers along with it on this sustainability journey. In 2009, it announced the creation of a worldwide sustainability product index. Step one was providing each of its suppliers with a survey of 15 simple but powerful questions to evaluate their own company's sustainability in four areas: energy and climate, natural resources, material efficiency, and people and community. Step two is to develop a global database of information on the life cycle of products to be shared on a public platform. And step three will be to translate the findings into a simple, convenient, easy to understand rating so customers can make choices and consume in a more sustainable way. Walmart is not second-guessing what these assessments, measures, and information systems will look like. However, it has said that by 2012, all direct import suppliers will be required to source 95% of their production from factories that receive one of Walmart's two highest ratings in audits for environmental and social practices, including standards of product safety, quality, and energy efficiency. In February 2010, it also committed to reducing 20 million metric tons of carbon pollution from its products' life cycles and supply chains over the next 5 years. That's equivalent to eliminating the annual greenhouse gas emissions from 3.8 million cars by 2015. To be sure, Walmart still has plenty of critics of its sustainability index, its labor practices, its supply chain performance, and its Goliath tactics. But to borrow from the Marvel comic-adapted movie Transformers, it is getting harder and harder to cast Walmart as the evil Megatron, which is part of the Decepticon race, and far more plausible to see it as Optimus Prime, an awesomely powerful yet ultimately well-intentioned transformer. The moral of the Walmart story is that it is making sustainability and responsibility scalable. Scott's take on it is that more than anything else, we see sustainability as mainstream. We believe working families should not have to choose between a product they can afford and a sustainable product. That is nothing short of the CSR holy grail, and the jury is still very much out, especially since Scott stepped down in 2009. But if anyone can tip us into the age of responsibility, it's the new sustainability superpower, Walmart. The limits of ethical consumerism. What makes Walmart such a good example of scalability is not just its size, but the principles underlying its actions, such as mainstreaming sustainability, measuring total impacts, empowering customers, working with suppliers, and setting audacious goals. Indeed, it is now part of an industry that seems intent on transforming itself, with many of the largest players like Tesco and Marks and Spencer trying to outcompete one another on the sustainability and responsibility stakes. This has come as a bit of a surprise to many, including so-called CSR experts. As the well-respected CSR commentator Malin Baker observed, British retailer Marks and Spencer used to be best known as a pillar of the establishment. No fiery, wild-eyed radical, it would do a select number of good things for the community, and it would steadfastly refuse to beat its own drum about it. All that has changed, and the measure of just how much could be seen with the retailer's recent pronouncement that it is aiming to become the world's most sustainable retailer by 2015. At the heart of this ambition is what it calls Plan A, because there is no Plan B, which sets out 100 sustainability targets and which they seem well on their way to achieving. These are indeed encouraging signs for the future. However, in order that we don't repeat past mistakes, it is worth looking back and learning a key lesson of retail history, namely that the so-called ethical consumer may unwittingly be hindering progress. That may seem like a crazy thing to say, but here is why I say it. Simply put, by creating a premium-priced niche market for ethical consumption, whether it be organic, fair trade, or eco-friendly, companies have been able to present a responsible front to the world while leaving the vast majority of their products, which are by implication less than ethical, unquestioned and unchanged. At the same time, a small group of usually well-off Western consumers have been able to ease their conscience by feeling that they are making a positive difference. Now let me be clear, I am not against organic or fair trade or eco-friendly products per se. That would be insane. Clearly, there are groups of producers, especially poor farmers in the third world, that have benefited enormously from these initiatives. What I am against is the voluntary nature and premium pricing of sustainable and responsible products. The combination of these two factors has ensured that, with one or two exceptions, these products have never gone to scale. Compared with the collective and ongoing impacts of mainstream shopping habits, ethical consumption, laudable as it is, has remained marginal at best and totally insignificant at worst. Let's look at some of the facts. The UK Soil Association launched the world's first organic standard in 1967, and Germany launched its Blue Angel eco-label in 1978. The first fair trade coffee, introduced by the Max Havelaar Foundation, was in 1988, and the Rainforest Alliance launched its Smart Wood certification in 1989. Today we even have oddities like carbon-neutral climate change chocolate, launched by Bloomsbury and Company. So we have had more than 40 years of ethical consumption, and where has that left us? Well, certainly it is a growing trend. In the UK, where the proportion of ethical consumers is among the highest in the world, a survey of 4,000 consumers by PricewaterhouseCoopers found that shoppers buying fair trade products rose from 20% in 2005 to 50% in 2008, and organic food purchasing increased from 22% to 43% over the same period. However, this £300 billion sector accounted for just 4% of the UK retail market in 2008, and only 60% of basic grocery products had sustainable alternatives, falling to 40% for some subcategories, such as clothing and non-food items. According to the PwC survey, the high prices associated with fair trade and organic products remained the inhibitor to further growth. On average, the price premium for environmentally and ethically friendly products, taken across 75 items at the UK's top six grocers, was 45%. Almost 50% of those shoppers surveyed said they were unwilling or unable to pay this premium, claiming that on average they were not willing to pay a premium in excess of 20% for greener alternatives. How then do we explain polls like the one done in 2009 by the Fair Trade Labelling Organisation among 14,500 people across 15 countries, which found that more than half said they were active ethical consumers? Well, as all professional market researchers will tell you, these figures are horribly skewed due to what is called the socially acceptable response bias. You're basically asking people if they are ethical, or if they care about poor farmers in the third world, or if they are okay with trashing the planet. Would you answer yes? The UK's Sustainable Consumption Roundtable confesses that they know that there is a considerable gap, the so-called value action gap, between people's attitudes, which are often pro-environmental, and their everyday behaviours. Fair trade coffee for you, sir. We know the value action gap is explained partly by price and availability of alternatives, but there is something else going on as well. Simply put, context matters. To illustrate this, Timothy Devine, author of The Myth of the Ethical Consumer, reports on a very interesting experiment he conducted while researching his book. The experiment took place at a coffee shop in central Sydney in Australia over a period of several weeks. This coffee shop displayed a large and prominent sign indicating the products available, their price, and active specials. To this was added, quite obtrusively, another special indicating, "We have fair trade coffee. No extra charge, just ask." Here's what he found. Unprompted, with only the sign to notify them of the availability of the ethical alternative, less than 1% of customers bothered to ask for fair trade coffee, even though it was the same price as normal coffee. However, when the barista prompted customers with a reminder that the ethical alternative was available, the number of customers opting for the fair trade option rose to 30%. They then went a step further and took the customer's privacy away. Each time the barista prompted a customer with the fair trade option, they ensured there was someone standing next to that person at the counter. In this situation, the number of ethical consumers rose to 70%. Throughout the experiment, Davini's research team gave different coloured cups to customers who indicated that they wanted the fair trade product. They then questioned those remaining in the coffee shop about the meaning of fair trade and what they thought they were doing by purchasing or not purchasing fair trade coffee. On the whole, they received informed and insightful answers. Customers talked about fair trade. They talked about the conditions of Guatemalan farmers. They could cite many reasons why they had opted for fair trade coffee. But, and it's a very big but, none of this meant anything. This is what Davini concluded. When a customer chose the fair trade alternative, his or her decision was based entirely on the context we had created. It had nothing to do with that person's values or preferences. This is a hugely important lesson. If we want to achieve scalability of sustainable and responsible products and services, we cannot leave it to the passive choices of consumers. Context is critical, and a little bit of peer pressure goes a long way. Choice editing for good. But do we really want to resort to public embarrassment to achieve scalability? The UK's Sustainable Consumption Roundtable, which was jointly hosted by the National Consumer Council and the Sustainable Development Commission, did some research on this question and concluded that the focus needs to be on creating a supportive framework for collective progress rather than exhorting individuals to go against the grain. This is the approach that we heard time and again in our engagement with consumers and business, encapsulated in the notion of, I will if you will. It is possible to make sustainable habits and choices easier to take up. By drawing on insights about consumer behavior and using people's preferences for purchasing shortcuts and what we call the trend towards choice editing. The idea of choice editing is likely to get free market fundamentalists all in a huff, but the fact is that manufacturers and retailers choice edit all the time on quality, price, aesthetics, and brand offering. The only difference is that now we are asking them to add sustainability and responsibility to their list of criteria. Walmart certainly wasn't the first to wake up to this possibility. In 1997, the UK retail chain Iceland, now the Big Food Group, announced that it would ban all ingredients derived from genetically modified crops from its own label products. Then chairman and chief executive Malcolm Walker said, "The proposal by other manufacturers and retailers to only label products which contain protein from GM soya or maize would result in probably less than 5% of processed foods being labeled, whereas if all GM derivatives are included, as much as 60% of processed foods could be labeled accordingly." Iceland's gamble paid off, and the response of customers was overwhelmingly supportive. As a result, Iceland continued its trailblazing race to the top by banning all artificial colours and flavours from its products and investing heavily in organic food. In fact, in June 2000, Iceland bought up 40% of the world's organic vegetable crop to become an organic-only supermarket. And herein lies the cautionary tale, because this time customers did not back the store's choice to stock only the more expensive organic products. Sales slumped and the company went into a financial crisis that resulted in Walker leaving under a cloud. Subsequently, Iceland brought back non-organic products and its sales and profitability were restored. There are two lessons from this case. First and most obviously, Iceland went too far ahead of its customers. Perhaps their shoppers were not conscious or committed enough. Perhaps the ethical case had not been made strongly enough by the company and by the UK's media, or at least not in the same way that the anti-GMO case had been made. But there is another way to read this. Perhaps it was not the moral ineptitude of customers, but rather the premium price tag that put the nail in the coffin of Iceland's pioneering pro-organics move. Perhaps you have to be the size of Walmart to achieve sufficient economies of scale to justify everyday low prices for sustainable and responsible products. And since there is only one Walmart, how can the rest of the world's companies achieve scalability of ethical consumerism without hitting the price premium wall? Government's visible hand. There is a very simple answer: regulation. Once again, as with choice editing, this is likely to bring Friedmanite free marketers out in a rash. However, we need to remember that Adam Smith never assumed that the free market was unregulated. He was, after all, a moral philosopher and assumed the existence of societal controls in which competition could flourish. He also probably never anticipated that his invisible hand of the market would spend quite so much time engaged in the act of self-pleasuring. Today, we know that free market capitalism is a myth, an idealized fantasy that never has existed and never will exist. Rather, what we have seen in practice, even in the world's largest free market capitalist country, is that the visible hand of state intervention is very active. For example, the reason that America, like most countries of the world, has such cheap oil and gas can be summed up in one word: subsidies. According to a 2009 Environmental Law Institute report, the US government paid roughly $72 billion to subsidize fossil fuels between 2002 and 2008. More than $54 billion of that was in the form of 23 different tax credits for oil, coal, and natural gas producers, including those overseas, most of which are permanent provisions of the US tax code. By contrast, renewables such as wind, solar, and hydropower receive merely $29 billion, much of it also in the form of tax credits, although in this case, credits that expire after set durations. And more than half of the renewable subsidy, $16.8 billion, went to the controversial biofuels production of ethanol from corn. Similarly, Europe subsidizes its agricultural and fishing industries to the tune of 48 billion euros, making up more than 40% of the EU budget. Leaving aside the ethics of both of these categories of subsidies on fossil fuels and agriculture, what it tells us is that we know how to lower prices on things that we want. We do it by letting governments create incentives for scaling up. The problem is that, until now, governments haven't been bold enough to intervene at a scale that would make sustainable and responsible production and consumption happen in a big way. Let's consider for a moment the way in which governments finally intervened in most countries in order to ban smoking in public places. What can we learn from this? First, we know that it took decades of scientific research to make the health case irrefutable. Second, the reforms were helped along by a major exposé of the lies and manipulation by Big Tobacco to undermine progressive legislation. Third, it took the weight of a major public body like the United Nations, in this case the World Health Organization, to legitimize the findings of the scientists. And lastly, it took courage by the politicians to take strong action that was so clearly in the public's best interest, but would inevitably attract big bully lobbying from the tobacco, restaurant, and pub industries. The interesting thing is that we have all but the fourth ingredient already in place for the broader sustainability and responsibility agenda. The science and research is mounting and calling for urgent action. Numerous companies have been exposed for wanton self-aggrandization, and the UN and other major bodies are putting their weight behind reforms. All that is still lacking is political courage, and even there we see some signs of movement. For example, the UK's climate change targets, enshrined in the Climate Change Act, are highly ambitious, committing the country to reduce its carbon emissions by 80% by 2050, with an interim target of 34% cuts by 2030. The simple fact is that, beyond a few products like iPods that create their own mass market driven, first by innovation and then by clever marketing and latent customer demand, most sustainable and responsible products and services need bold government intervention to make them competitive and scalable. There are at least two good reasons for this. First, as we have already seen, many of the less sustainable products and services are being subsidized, so there is no level playing field on which to compete. And second, most of the more sustainable and responsible products and services that need scaling stray into the territory of being public goods, where the market fails. Speaking to me in 2008, sustainability guru Amory Lovins claimed that there are 60 to 80 well-known market failures to buying energy and resource efficiency. Put another way, if we want CSR to be scalable, smart government regulation is absolutely essential. A flotilla of little boats. Of course, the warm-out effect and government intervention are all very well in countries where there are massive branded companies and the state is in firm control of a relatively stable and effective political landscape. But what about in countries where governments are weak, failing, or corrupt? Are there other ways to achieve scalability? And more to the point, what do we mean by scalability? Is bigger always better, or can we still cling to the notion of small is beautiful, as the pioneering economist E.F. Schumacher argued in 1973? Certainly the muesli-eating, sandal-wearing, New Age approach to small is beautiful has been rather more of an advertisement for small is groovy, but ultimately ineffectual. But what if we could do both big and small at the same time? I discussed the issue of scalability with Simon Zadek, a widely respected thought leader on the civil corporation and accountability. Reflecting on climate change as an example, he set out the challenge as follows. How do we move from an increasingly discredited clean development mechanism approach, where the evidence is increasingly of huge abuse of funds, huge misrepresentation of claims, and altogether rather a waste of time and a lot of money, to a mechanism that can mobilize and move $50, $100, $200 billion a year transborder, that can mobilize, assess, invest, monitor, and communicate credibly in the area of mitigation or adaptation? It seems to me, he said, we need the equivalent of a global fund for HIV, AIDS, and malaria on steroids. So that is one version of a collaborative mode, continued Zadek, that will in any case spring up at a micro level. But can we go to scale, and indeed is scale a large institutional functionality, or is it a flotilla of little boats? This is where Chris Anderson's Web 2.0 concept of the long tail is very useful. The long tail, named after the extended tail of a statistical distribution curve, is the idea that selling less to more people is big business. It's the business model that has spawned most successful companies of the Web 2.0 age. The long tail questions the conventional wisdom that says success is about generating blockbusters and superstars, those rare few products and services that become runaway bestsellers. Anderson sums up his message by saying that, one, the tail of available variety is longer than we think. Two, it's now within our reach economically. And three, all those niches, when aggregated, can make up a significant market. He also notes that this long tail revolution has been made possible by the digital age, which has dramatically reduced the costs of customized production and niche distribution. There are three enablers of successful long tail businesses, according to Anderson. First, democratizing the tools of production, for example, digicams, content editing software, and blogging tools. Two, democratizing the tools of distribution, for example, Amazon, eBay, iTunes, and Netflix. And three, connecting supply and demand, such as what Google, blogs, and Rotten Tomatoes does. The long tail of CSR. Back in 2008, having read Anderson's book, I set to wondering, is there a long tail of CSR? And if so, what does it look like? To me, the long tail of CSR is all about extending the reach of CSR and improving its ability to satisfy specific social and environmental needs. Let's use Anderson's enablers as a framework for thinking about this. First, democratizing the tools of CSR production. For me, this is about breaking CSR silos and extending CSR beyond multinationals. At the early stages of CSR adoption, it is often confined to public relations, corporate affairs even, or marketing departments. As CSR implementation matures, responsibility tends to migrate to specialized CSR departments of various descriptions: environment, health and safety, accountability, corporate citizenship, and so on. However, these versions of CSR are like the Hollywood model of blockbuster films. They suggest that CSR is about a few high-visibility programs that are designed by CSR experts and delivered by big companies. By contrast, democratizing CSR production would mean firstly embedding CSR across the organization, in other words, making it the responsibility of operations managers, financial managers, shop floor workers, basically everyone. This is only possible if CSR becomes part of the culture and incentive systems of an organization. CSR would also need to be extended beyond the usual suspects, in other words, the high-profile branded companies. It needs to be extended to less visible business-to-business and national rather than multinational organizations, as well as to small and medium-sized enterprises and down the supply chain. Second, if we look at democratizing the tools of CSR production, well, to date, CSR has mainly been distributed via a few select projects, typically philanthropic or charitable activities, in which the company offers to help the less fortunate masses. Usually, the nature and scope of CSR activities is determined top-down and offered as a fairly undifferentiated service. For example, Nike might decide to focus on sponsoring sports teams, events, and celebrities, and Coca-Cola might choose water as its key CSR issue. The most common delivery mechanisms are money, in the form of sponsorship or other kinds of charity, or for the more advanced companies, adhering to generic CSR codes and standards. By contrast, democratizing the tools of CSR distribution should include allowing staff to participate in CSR delivery through volunteer programs and developing more geographically tailored and sector-specific CSR codes and standards, such as the Roundtable on Sustainable Palm Oil or the Global Reporting Initiative Guidelines for HIV and AIDS Reporting. Beyond this, embracing the bottom of the pyramid markets and supporting social entrepreneurs will allow the reach of CSR to be extended so that the needs of formerly unserved or underserved people can be met. Third, looking at connecting CSR supply and demand. Well, traditionally, CSR has been offered in the form of grants by multinational head offices, which control the budget and set the criteria by which prospective philanthropic projects should be selected. For the more advanced companies, this has been extended to adherence by their operations to corporate codes of CSR practice and communicating this through CSR reports. Demand has typically come from community groups applying to corporate foundations for funding, or NGOs taking an activist approach to demanding improved CSR practices. By contrast, connecting the long tail of CSR supply and demand will rely on increasingly using cross-sector partnerships and multi-stakeholder groups. For example, Rio Tinto works with the World Conservation Union to identify biodiversity needs and satisfy them through appropriate CSR activities. Companies may also use extended stakeholder networks of community groups, social entrepreneurs, and microfinance enterprises to better match their capacity or to make a positive impact among those who can most benefit, as BP is doing with smokeless stoves in India and SC Johnson is doing with cleaning products in Kenya. Hence, applying the long-tail concept to CSR requires a different way of thinking about how CSR is generated, delivered, and managed. It means making CSR a more inclusive and embedded process within the company, and a more diverse and far-reaching set of activities outside the company. It also means creating meaningful stakeholder partnerships to ensure that the right kinds of CSR benefit the right kinds of people, where and when they need it. The long tail, in a nutshell, according to Anderson, is culture unfiltered by scarcity. So by extension, the long tail of CSR, in a nutshell, should be responsibility liberated by collaboration. Bottom of the pyramid. One of the most popular visions of scalability is C.K. Prahalad and Stuart Hart's concept of doing business at the bottom of the pyramid, the so-called BOP markets, the roughly 4 billion people living on less than $1,500 a year. The concept was popularized in several academic papers in 2002 and subsequently by Prahalad's book, The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid. Prahalad argues that the poor, defined as people living on less than $2 a day, represent a market size of $13 trillion. Alan Hammond, vice president of the World Resources Institute, believes it may be as much as $15 trillion a year. Estimates in the book The Next 4 Billion, drawing on data and income from 110 countries and standardized expenditure data from 36 countries across the globe, have lower estimates at $5 trillion. But still, this is by no means trivial. Much of this colossal market will remain untapped, however, unless business learns to do business differently. In order to access the bottom of the pyramid, argue Prahalad and Hart, several myths need to be busted. For example, contrary to popular belief, BOP markets are brand conscious and connected, and BOP customers accept new technology. However, in order to conduct business in these markets, companies have to create the capacity to consume by making products affordable, accessible, and available. The provision by Hindustan Lever of single-serve sachets of shampoo in India is now a classic and much-debated case in point. Building trust is also a prerequisite. I remember asking Muhammad Yunus why the Grameen Bank had succeeded where so many other commercial banks had failed in doing business with the poor. His answer was that he began the bank in an area that he had lived and worked in for many years. He had built up social capital and earned their trust. As a result, he was able to grow a $2.5 billion banking enterprise with over 7 million active clients affecting 35 million family members. Most remarkably, Grameen's loan repayment rate is over 98%, and borrowers of the bank own 90% of its shares. By 2007, the microcredit model had scaled to over 50 countries, with more than 3,000 microcredit institutions reaching over 130 million clients. Of these, 93 million, up from 7.6 million in 1997, were among the poorest when they took their first loan. And of these poorest clients, 85%, or nearly 80 million, were women. The BOP model has been hotly debated and criticized. Speaking to me in 2008, Hart conceded two main problems. One is that companies will take existing unsustainable, polluting, or toxic products and strip some of the cost out and take it into these underserved markets, and then just do a lot more environmental damage. The second criticism, captured by Anil Kanani in The Misfortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, is that companies are entering rural villages and urban slums and shanty towns and just selling stuff to poor people that they don't really need. Extractive products that are just going to take what little cash they have in their pockets, extract wealth, not create it, and at the end of the day do more harm than good from the standpoint of poverty alleviation. On this point, Yunus told me, our primary responsibility is to lift the poor at the bottom of the pyramid, rather than see it as an opportunity to make money. So we should not look at them as consumers of our product, we should see them as potential producers, potential creative people who can take charge of their own life and transform it. Taking these concerns into account, Hart, with Eric Simanis and others at Cornell University, has been leading an initiative to create a BOP protocol, or BOP 2.0 model. Hart describes it as a new business process for actually engaging in those communities, building trust and then co-creating businesses. There is an attitude difference that embodies humility. It's a co-creation methodology rather than a talk-down imposition where the presumption is rich people are smarter, poor people are dumb, and are victims. You have to change your mindset and think, we could be partners and colleagues, or we could actually work together to develop a business that combines the best of both. We could bring incredible next-generation clean technology, but there's a lot of local knowledge that if we combine those together, imagine what sort of interesting business we could create that could make a better way to live. And as an example of scalability in this approach, Stuart Hart cites a BOP protocol initiative in the US with Ascension Health, which is the third largest hospital corporation in the United States, focused on the 50 million people in the US with no health insurance. Another example of BOP scalability is the Tata Nano, the $2,500 car launched in 2008 in India. The mission began back in 2003 when Ratan Tata, chairman of the Tata Motors Group and the $50 billion Tata conglomerate, set a challenge to build a people's car. Tata gave an engineering team three requirements for the new vehicle. It should be low cost, adhere to regulatory requirements, and achieve performance targets such as fuel efficiency and acceleration capacity. By design, it is small and eco-efficient, and while many wring their hands over the environmental impacts of a billion Indians driving a car, no one has an ethical right to deny the same access to individual mobility that virtually the whole population of the developed world enjoys. Other big companies have also got involved. For example, Philips is actively targeting rural India with two products, the smokeless stove and lighting products in the Philips Sustainable Model in Lighting Everywhere range, also called Smile. At Philips, we have a strategy in place to address the needs of consumers at the bottom of the pyramid, said Philips India CEO Murali Sivaraman. We look at this section of society as a viable market and have developed products catering to their needs. Similarly, Envirofit, a spin-out from the University of Colorado, claims that its $20 stoves cut smoke and toxic emissions by 80% and halve the amount of fuel that is needed. Its goal is to sell 10 million in the developing world over the next 5 years. According to Simon Bishop, head of policy at the Shell Foundation, which seed-funded the Envirofit venture, everything we do is about applying business thinking. Blessed unrest. Another way to think about scalability is as a much more grassroots movement. Indeed, Paul Hawken, in his book Blessed Unrest, subtitled How the Largest Movement in the World Came into Being and Why No One Saw It Coming, suggests that they have already gone to scale on sustainability and responsibility in one sense. The title comes from a quote of Martha Graham to Agnes DeMille in Dance to the Piper. And I quote, "There is a vitality, a life force, an energy, a quickening that is translated through you into action. And because there is only one of you in all time, this expression is unique. You have to keep open and aware directly to the urges that motivate you. Keep the channel open. There is no satisfaction whatever at any time. There is only a queer, divine satisfaction, a blessed unrest that keeps us marching and makes us more alive." Drawing inspiration from this idea, Hawken believes that in this movement without a center, there are over 1 or maybe even 2 million organizations working towards ecological sustainability and social justice. The scale of this movement for change has gone largely undetected, he believes, because it is not formalized. It is a movement without central control or appointed leaders. He describes it as follows. The movement can't be divided because it is so atomized, a collection of small pieces loosely joined. It forms, dissipates, and then regathers quickly, without central leadership, command, or control. Rather than seeking dominance, this unnamed movement strives to disperse concentrations of power. It has been capable of bringing down governments, companies, and leaders through witnessing, informing, and massing. The quickening of the movement in recent years has come about through information technologies becoming increasingly accessible and affordable to people everywhere. Its clout resides in its ideas, not in force. Andres Edwards argues that we have gone from a sustainability movement to a sustainability revolution. He bases this on three distinct phases: genesis, critical mass, and diffusion. He notes that, and I quote, "Whereas movements tend to have narrower objectives and are led by a charismatic leader, such as Mahatma Gandhi, social revolutions have wider objectives and are led by a large and diverse number of individuals." Hawkins sees this disaggregated collective acting in defense of the earth and society, saying that the shared activity of hundreds of thousands of non-profit organizations can be seen as humanity's immune response to toxins like political corruption, economic disease, and ecological degradation. A key insight from the metaphor is that when we are sick, we feel the disease, but we seldom feel the immune system working away in the background to restore health. In the same way, the mass movement for sustainability and responsibility has been operating under the political and economic radar, focusing on damage control and restoration of vitality to our societies and ecosystems. In an audacious attempt to collate and categorize the multifarious organizations working to bring about positive change, Hawkins set up WISER, which stands for the World Index of Social and Environmental Responsibility. It is a collaborative platform for the movement. The first step was setting up WISER.org, the world's largest free and editable international directory of NGOs and socially responsible organizations, numbering over 110,000 in 243 countries, territories, and sovereign lands in 2008. There are also parallel sites planned for WISER Business and WISER Government. Collaborative social entrepreneurship. A related movement that we have already introduced is the social enterprise movement. At the heart of the social entrepreneurial ethic is the achievement of scale. Catalyst Bill Drayton believes this is not only possible, but is happening already. He says, "To question whether social entrepreneurs can achieve large-scale change is to doubt the existence of Florence Nightingale, Maria Montessori, William Wilberforce, Faisal Abed, Jimmy Wales, or the 2,700 Ashoka Fellows." But how does this happen? What do social entrepreneurs know about scalability that we could learn from? According to Drayton, part of the answer lies in their ability to mobilize other change agents. He describes it as follows: "Every social entrepreneur is a mass recruiter of local change makers. Here is one of the few significant structural differences between the social and business entrepreneur. The social entrepreneur has no interest in capturing a market and digging a moat. Instead, the goal, indeed, is to change the world. The way social entrepreneurs do this almost always is to make their idea as understandable, attractive, safe, and supported as necessarily precise so that local people in community after community after community will recognize that the idea would be hugely valuable to their community and also judge that they could make that idea fly. The moment one or several local people make that decision, stand up, and champion the idea, they have become local change makers. They will disrupt local patterns, they will recruit others to be change makers, and a few will later become large-scale social entrepreneurs in their own right." A second way social entrepreneurs achieve scale is by collaborating with each other on their business. We have already seen how FreePlay collaborated with innovators in the medical industry to come up with the fetal heart rate monitor, and how A Little World collaborated with numerous technology and banking partners to develop and deliver its microbanking services. Similarly, we saw how the Grameen Bank has been collaborating with French food company Danone since 2006 to fight malnutrition in Bangladesh by producing a yogurt enriched with crucial nutrients at a price of around 6 cents, which even the poorest can afford. Social media sites like Amazee are also allowing social entrepreneurs to collaborate. Amazee calls itself the Global Action Network and cites successful groups that have engaged its members in building an IT learning center in Sri Lanka, or planning meetings of internet entrepreneurs in Zurich, or ensuring the complete supply of running water in small South African villages. Similarly, the Mayflower Foundation in Lagos in Nigeria aims to work as a coordinated, synergistic and cooperative body for pooling and integrating social development and CSR efforts to directly impact up to 100,000 citizens and as many as 300,000 indirectly. Drayton concludes that once there are several hundred leading social entrepreneurs in a field across the continents, one can be confident that a jump to the next paradigm in the field is near. Crowdsourcing CSR solutions. In today's world, the way social entrepreneurs increasingly achieve collaboration is through technology. Indeed, one of McKinsey's top 10 tech-supported business innovation trends is collaboration at scale. This is where the Web 2.0 concept of crowdsourcing comes into its own. The term was coined by Jeff Howe in a June 2006 Wired magazine article called "The Rise of Crowdsourcing," in which he argued that technology has shrunk the gap between professionals and amateurs. Howe saw crowdsourcing as an alternative to outsourcing. Crowdsourcing is closely linked to the wisdom of crowds ideas, popularized by a 2004 book by James Surowiecki in the same title book. Surowiecki's opening anecdote captures the book's central tenet of why the many are smarter than the few. He recounts how Victorian English polymath and half-cousin of Charles Darwin, Francis Galton, discovered that it was the crowd at a country fair that accurately guessed the weight of an ox, when their individual guesses were averaged, whereas individual guesses on their own were invariably inaccurate. Today there are numerous examples, the most famous of which is Wikipedia, the free online collaborative encyclopedia, launched in 2001, which today has more than 16 million entries. Founder Jimmy Wales is quick to point out that Wikipedia is a social innovation, not a technical innovation. All the tools needed to create Wikipedia existed in 1995, when Ward Cunningham invented the wiki editing concept. Wikipedia was, in fact, Wales's second attempt. Before Wikipedia, he explains, we had a previous project called Newpedia. The goal was the same, a free encyclopedia for everyone, but the method was different, very top-down, very academic. The problem was, it was just too slow. And what is all this to do with CSR? Well, when it comes to CSR challenges, sometimes speed, not to mention wisdom, is also of the essence. Like when Hurricane Katrina hit and some social entrepreneurs responded by developing People Finder, a kind of crowdsourcing software that was developed to locate missing victims. Or what happened when the Haiti earthquake struck on the 12th of January 2010. Let's look at this one in a bit more detail. In the weeks after the tragedy, text messages to the dedicated Haiti emergency short code 4636 increased about 10% each day, with about one text a second coming through. With the scale of requests flooding in, how were the emergency response units to make sense of all the desperate messages, let alone respond? Faced with this conundrum, Mission 4636 was born, a joint project by Frontline SMS, Ushahidi, Samasource, and Crowdflower, Together, they decided to deploy a critical emergency communication system. This massive effort, crowdsourced across multiple non-profit and for-profit companies and individual volunteers from around the globe and the country. In an interview with Envision Good TV's Katrina Hepler, web developer for Ushahidi, Brian Herbert, explained how it worked. Someone on the ground in Haiti will send a text message of their location and their needs that populates a queue that is mostly all Creole messages that we can't read because we speak English. The thousands of volunteers from 14 countries will then take the messages, translate them, add any additional notes, and categorize and geotag them. And when it goes to Ushahidi, they do a bit more in-depth research into each message and pass it on to the Coast Guard or Southern Command, and they do the emergency response. The power of crowdsourcing is that it can respond to diversity. Robert Munro, Translation Volunteer Coordinator at Frontline SMS, explained that they were looking at ways to automate the processing of messages. But this is not easy when you get a lot of variation, as you do in Creole, between spellings. So we had to make the decision, he said, whether to crowdsource or to automate. Leila Jana, founder of Samasource, adds that this whole project is not just an example of the power of crowdsourcing to be manifested in new ways like disaster response, but also the power of social media and the new technology we have. Between Skype and Twitter and Google Documents, we've been able to collaborate with people that I've never met in person, and that would never have been possible even just a couple of years ago. Smart versus dumb growth. All of these examples of growing, scalable responses to sustainability and responsibility crises are unknowingly questioning, if not entirely undermining, the centuries-old rallying cry for a steady-state economy, put forward by a long line of philosophers and economists, people like John Stuart Mill, John Maynard Keynes, Robert Solow, Nikolai Georgescu Rogan, and Herman Daly. The steady state or zero growth proposition begins with a presumption that growth is bad. It draws on a wealth of evidence, which on the face of it is rather convincing. Clearly, economic growth has scaled up our negative impacts, from resource depletion and environmental destruction to community disintegration and cultural imperialism. Furthermore, the much-touted benefits of growth have not been equitably distributed between countries or even within countries, nor has wealth trickled down, as promised by the neoclassical economists. Besides this, many of the benefits of growth are mere phantoms. For example, happiness in the US has remained fairly constant over the past 50 years, despite continuous economic growth and huge increases in personal disposable income. The Index for Sustainable Economic Welfare, designed by former World Bank economist Herman Daly, reaches similar conclusions. While GDP has gone up since the 1950s in the US, the UK, and many other countries where the study has been replicated, quality of life, as measured by the Index for Sustainable Economic Welfare, which subtracts negative externalities like the cost of disease, war, and pollution from GDP, has either leveled off or declined since the 1970s. Today, the genuine progress indicator continues to refine, test, and largely confirm the Index for Sustainable Economic Welfare hypothesis. There comes a point, Daly explained to me in 2008, where the benefits of expansion of the economy, which are real, may be outweighed by the cost inflicted on the rest of the system by the expanded economy. This results in what Daly famously called uneconomic growth, of which there are five variations. First, jobless growth, where the economy grows but does not expand opportunities for employment. Second, ruthless growth, where the proceeds of economic growth mostly benefit the rich. Third, voiceless growth, where economic growth is not accompanied by extension of democracy or empowerment. Fourth, rootless growth, where economic growth squashes people's cultural identity, and 5, futureless growth, where the present generation squanders resources needed by future generations. The consequent call for zero growth was especially strong following the emergence of the ecological economics and new economics movements in the 1980s and 1990s. But more and more, this approach is being questioned. Jonathan Porritt confesses that, despite having co-founded the Green Party in the UK in the 1970s, he's had reservations about the anti-growth thinking for a long time. There are two reasons for this, which Porritt explained to me as follows. I'm endlessly referring to the importance of massive growth in solar technology, massive growth in sustainable and organic agricultural systems, massive growth in better waste management practices. So a lot of the upbeat side of the sustainability agenda these days is actually growthist. If we don't get these huge transformations in these different sectors of the economy, which entails the creation of enormous amounts of new economic value, we're not going to get to the point we need to get to. The second reason for Porritt's skepticism is that the concept of zero growth seems to imply a static, no-progress view of human nature and humankind. He put it this way, it sort of implies that sustainability is a fixed point, and once you've got there, you can relax. And that seems to me such a fallacious concept of human nature and what it is that makes humanity so special that it doesn't have any psychological authority. If growth means getting to a point and then nothing, moving or changing dynamically, then I've got no real interest in it. In his book, Capitalism as If the World Matters, Porritt proposes that we change the debate from being about unlimited versus zero growth to being about smart versus dumb growth. Dumb growth is virtually everything we've been doing for the past century. Smart growth is something more difficult, but still, Porritt believes, ultimately possible. He explained it as follows. If you can do the decoupling of economic growth and the environmental footprint, and the recoupling on the social outcomes, the improvement in well-being, then you can theoretically see how you'd get to a point where growth makes sense. Of course, it has to be so different from what we have now that some people would say, that's not really growth as we know it. That's a completely different measure of progress. Well, yes, that's precisely the point. It has to be a completely different measure of progress. The era of leading big on CSR dawns. One of the new leaders in this quest for smart growth is Unilever. CEO Paul Polman said in a 2009 interview with McKinsey, "This world has tremendous challenges. The challenges of poverty, of water, of global warming, climate change. And businesses like ours have a role to play in that. And frankly, to me, that's very appealing." He went on to say, "We have every day in our business about 2 billion customers that use our brands. And so there's a tremendous opportunity. And if we do the right thing, we can actually make major progress in society." This drive to make a major difference seems, if anything, to have got bigger over the past year. At least that's the impression you get from Unilever's new Sustainable Living Plan, which it launched recently. In it, they committed to double the size of the company while halving the environmental footprint of their products, as well as sourcing 100% of their agricultural ingredients sustainably by 2015 and helping 1 billion people out of poverty. Commitments like that are what Sandy Ogg, chief HR officer for Unilever, calls leading big. Speaking to Polly Curtis, director of the Cambridge Programme for Sustainability Leadership, he said, "There's so much going on in the world now that if you don't have amplification and time compression, then it doesn't rumble. So I call that leading big. You can't let it drool or dribble out into an organisation like ours and expect to have any impact." The fact of the matter is that without leading big on sustainability and responsibility, CSR efforts no longer have any real credibility. Leading big is absolutely essential if we are to break the pattern of dumb growth and CSR ineffectiveness. I mentioned before that the dual acid test of CSR 2.0 is admission and ambition. Companies have to show their willingness to set bold, audacious targets that will reverse the negative social and environmental trends. In today's world of low trust and information overload, only bold leadership on CSR will inspire action and build credibility. Unilever and others are pointing the way and deserve our congratulations and support. They also require our unrelenting scrutiny to ensure that leading big is not simply talking big, but rather acting big, making real change happen at scale and at pace.